clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right. This may be one of the most perfect titles for what we're living right now and for your role in it ever.
Yeah, I love it. It's what I use on my SiriusXM radio program as the theme song. So I was thrilled that we were able to get permission to use it for the book.
So let's do something a little different for your audience.
Please.
All right, the book's coming out June 1st. Thank you for jumping the date that my show starts, June 4th, because I didn't have enough pressure already. Appreciate it, my friend. But let's test some of the theories that are in this for them, right? Because people, if they listen to you, they love you, but they may not know the whole thing. So you were in love with Reagan.
True.
You worked for Bush 1. You're a Republican. True or true?
True. Absolutely true.
So that you're admitting you're a Republican.
I'm admitting that I was a Republican.
I said you are a Republican. You said yes.
No, I wasn't listening closely enough.
Well,
I screwed up already.
So tell them how you got to where you are.
Well, I grew up in a Republican household. Mm-hmm. I came of age in the Reagan 80s. When I registered to vote when I turned 18 in 1980, there was no question as to which party I would join. I would join the Republican Party. And for 30 years, I was not only a loyal Republican voter, but very active in the party. And I had unique experiences at all levels that culminated when I was 29 in being appointed to a sub-cabinet level position in Papa Bush, Bush 41's administration. And Papa Bush was my kind of a Republican. If Papa Bush and those of his ilk were still running the Republican Party, I'd still be a Republican. But by 2010, I'd had enough. Barack Obama was the first Democratic presidential candidate for whom I ever voted. I'd voted for plenty of Ds, but that was the break point. It's a long story told in the book, mm-hmm. but it was really largely over foreign policy that I got off the GOP train because I didn't believe we were any longer hunting those responsible for September 11.
And it's interesting how the party has evolved on that in this administration of Trump. Now, one of the things you just alluded to here that people should know, one of the values of this book. So you wrote articles over 15 years,
right?
And you put them into categories. I think, what is it, politics, profiles, life, and MISC. MISC is always the best category, by the way, miscellaneous. But what you do after each of them is you think about where your head would be today on the same topic. And that is great value, and a lot of people don't do that.
Yeah, thank you.
And they don't do it because they're afraid. Because they don't want people to think, oh, what I said then was wrong, or this, or, you know, where's my continuity, my consistency? And you did it right out of the box. You wrote a piece about hard work, you know, very Reagan-era value. Hard work, as long as you work hard, you'll be fine. That's not as true as it used to be. And you reflect that in your afterword. How so?
So here's the funny thing. I published, by my count, 1,047 columns between 2001 and 2016. As I combed through the Daily News and Philadelphia Inquirer archives, I found a column from 1985 that I forgot I'd published. Chris, I was in law school.
Were you a first year?
First year in law school.
It was an
end of my first
piece.
Year. An opinion piece, right, about America being the land of opportunity. Now, I still believe that America is a land of opportunity, but that luck has a great deal to do with it. And some get dealt a bad hand from which they never recover. And so, yeah, that's a great example of where when I dusted that baby off, of course I wanted to publish it again, but with the reflections of someone who's now 56 years old and taking a look at what I now view of life. I have no problem calling myself out and admitting the many instances where I was wrong in this book.
Well, you evolve also. You know, times change, situations change, principles remain the same for people like you anyway, if they were hard set to begin with. The idea of when you started this journey, just after 9/11.
Right.
What an interesting time to come into the perspective business.
True. And the very first column that I published as a columnist is one that advocates Rudy Giuliani, a name very familiar to you. You just interviewed him again last week. I advocate that he's the appropriate choice to be the nation's first Secretary of Homeland Security. That's how I used my first 700-word column. By the way, in retrospect, I was wrong.
Why?
Tom Ridge, having nothing to do with his representation of the president, but Tom Ridge, who was the nation's first secretary, tremendous, hell of a guy, did a great job.
And you needed, because Ridge was a governor, right?
True.
And he needed that skill set because Homeland Security had no business in the framework of government at that time. Nobody was sharing information. Homeland Security was asking them to do exactly the opposite. So you needed an executive who knew how to deal with battling agencies. Ridge wound up being a good choice. People can debate the policy choices, but a lot of them were not his. So you started off in this business. You've done politics. You've run for office.
I have. When I was in law school, I ran for the state legislature.
Would you do it again?
I've got a lot of kids I'm educating.
It's not a no. I'd like a yes or no, if you don't mind.
What is this, Cuomo Live?
That's right.
Can you bring me back and grill me? It's a maybe.
Why? You're right. So good. So you're not closed off.
No, I'm not closed off.
I push you on that because what a rare commodity you are. Somebody who takes so much time to understand things here, but also here, and have dealt with the wins and losses down there, right? That's the trifecta of how you come into your own as an adult. Your head, your heart, and your gumption, let's just say, to be anatomically neutral about it. You have gone through all those phases. You know who you are. You know what you're about. And that's why you believe the things that you do. And that's why you argue for and against what you do. Rare qualities in leaders these days on the elected side.
Well, we don't reward people who are evidentiary thinkers and independent in their view. I just don't subscribe, and I watch enough of Chris Cuomo to know that we're kindred spirits in this regard. I don't subscribe to those faux ideological boxes, all liberal, progressive, or all conservative. It's not how I view the world. It's not how people that I interact with view the world.
Then why do people like that keep getting elected?
Because passion rules. It rules the airwaves, much as I hate to admit it, in the world in which we live. And consequently, the stranglehold that many of those who stir the pot for a living have over elected officials and primary voters, I think has distorted the entire process for the country.
You think if Reagan had run against Trump, he would have won?
No, I don't. I think that the timing was right. I sure as hell didn't see it coming, by the way. You know, you talk about admitting my failings and where I've gotten things wrong. Any number of times I said that Donald Trump would never run, much less win, and of course I was wrong. But no, I think that the climate has been 30 years in the making, mm-hmm. and that it has been largely fostered by men with microphones who don't seek good governance. They want to stir the pot, foment dissent, so that they can laugh all the way to the bank.
Smerconish family comes from coal country.
Right.
In terms of the immigrant process, do you think that your family would have the same success if they came to the country now as they did back then?
I would hope so.
Hard-fought success, by the way. No easy path. You'll read it in the book. But what I'm saying is,
right.
What do you think?
I think that we were very fortunate. I think that, you know, my father's side of the family is from the Austria-Hungarian Empire. My mother's side of the family from the former Yugoslavia. Columns that I've written that are in the book do talk about those roots. I'm fortunate in that I've been blessed not only with the right area to grow up. I think that the Philadelphia suburbs were a perfect match for me, but also that somewhere in this DNA that has so many shortcomings is a pretty good work ethic. And I still believe, going back to the very first essay in the book, that it is a land of opportunity, but luck plays a role.
And those jobs that you had as relatively unskilled but hard-working, determined, they don't exist the same way. That's why I asked the question, because who knows if they would have gotten the foothold. You know, the Cuomo family, he was a ditch digger. He wound up being in the grocery business. I don't know that he would be able to get...
Yeah, well, mine came out of the mines. Both sides of the family, they worked in the Pennsylvania coal mines.
I actually, my mother's father, we learned in one of those ancestry.com, 23andMe deal. My mother's father was in Castoga County, Pennsylvania, and he was doing some kind of farm and then mine work. We never knew. He never talked about it, ever.
Could have been an Eagles fan.
Wound up in Brooklyn. No. Death first, brother. Death first. They got the color right, but the team's wrong. Now, let me ask you something.
Yeah.
About the world of fact, okay?
Oh, boy.
You'll find this in An Immigrant's Dream Still Means Something.
Right.
Thoughtful, 2007, the article comes from. But in the afterword, it says there's a reference to your mother.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And you talk about one of the stories about your mother. Like the time when Mom drove my brother and me to Little League Baseball and decided to step in the batter's box only to hit one over the left field fence.
How could I make that up?
Very easily,
no,
I'm thinking.
I would never do that.
How tall is your mother?
Mom would not like me to give any vital signs, other than to say she's vital and working and watching.
Had she ever played this game in her life?
Heck no.
And she hit a home run?
Absolutely. She just was there to drive my brother and me to
practice. It sounds very Trumpy. I'm telling you that right now.
No. If I said it about me, it might be Trumpian. If I'm saying it about Mom, it's gospel.
Did she have a house dress on?
I'm not allowed to answer that. Right.
Your mother got in the batting box and hit a home run.
Yeah, as we were there for tryouts, Little League tryouts. True. Couldn't make it up.
How did you do?
Not as well as my mother. But it was one of those snow fences, you know, that you see on, at a construction
site. Whatever it was.
Yeah.
Whose mom hits a home run like
mine.
That? Mine. Back then. Now, you know, you have generations of women athletes who are doing it, but she wasn't one.
No.
I mean, suburbs of Philly, she had a bat in her hands. It was a weapon. True or false?
My mother used a yardstick, a five-cent yardstick.
That's for people she loved. I'm saying for people outside
right.
the family.
Yeah, but that was the weapon of choice. If we did something wrong, we hid the yardstick. That was the first move.
Jokers to the right, clowns to the left. Biased? Nobody's as afraid of jokers as they are about clowns.
No, I'm casting equal aspersions on each. Clowns and jokers, in my view, are synonyms for this book title.
So let me ask you something, because, you know, this is the blessing and the curse. The blessing with you is that you look at things from both sides. Often, I will hear you on your show on the weekend take on an argument that I bet you kind of agree with, but it's about how that person is making the argument. And that's where you're going to go, and you're going to test it. And I get it. You know, now we're in a moment where that just doesn't happen anymore. People are completely siloed. And we keep saying it, but it keeps getting worse. Where is the prescription? Like, even the school shootings. Arnie Duncan was on this morning. He's got this interesting, provocative idea of let's have the parents pull their kids out of school after Labor Day and let the lawmakers know we're not putting our kids back in until you do something. Now, obviously, it'd have to be short-lived, right? Otherwise, you'd
right.
have a huge crisis at home just with home care, let alone education. And I said, well, you can also start by hardening up the schools, find some common ground. You know, people want safer schools. Can't harden up the schools. It's ridiculous. What are you going to do at recess? What are you going to do at dismissal? So you just shut off the idea. You know that you have huge common ground there. Where is progress?
This is going to sound counterintuitive from one guy, two guys who make their living on the airwaves, but people need to change the channel more. This rote allegiance that they have to ideologically driven programming, where they go to get their instruction, their talking points. And the irony is, we live in an era of such choice. You know, so many channels of cable and so many channels of terrestrial radio, but also satellite radio. Whatever you're looking for out there, you can find it. But people are no longer sampling the marketplace of ideas. Instead, they're, as you put it, siloed in and being reinforced in their belief.
You know, I think that that's a little bit of the burden of stratification, Michael, which is that, yes, there's something for everyone. But I think that right now, at least in this early phase of a gazillion channels, is they're looking for what they already believe.
Right, reinforcement.
And instead of, like, you know, your prescription would be move around.
Sure.
You know, listen to this one, listen to that. They don't want to do that.
Right.
And now, because there are very few generalists, you know, the very few shows like ours where you bring on both sides, they come on and you go at it, they don't want that. It's frustrating. Don't make me think about why I believe what I believe. It's already ingrained. I'm done with this. And you can't be open to the other side if you're in that mindset. It's a problem.
I think that people who hold views that are independent and not ideologically tethered have allowed themselves to be cast as being weak or as in lacking conviction. I have plenty of conviction on a whole variety of issues. I know you do as well. They just don't fit neatly into one side or the other of an ideological spectrum.
So where do you think we go? One of the things that, you know, in this compendium
right.
of articles, you're by definition dealing with things that have happened. Where do you think the next chapter of this book, where do you think it is going to live in terms of what kinds of issues, what kinds of challenges that this country faces, and therefore you too with your pen and your mind?
So I think that the book is a great snapshot of a post-9/11 world, mm-hmm. the first 15 years of a post-9/11 world. I wanted it to be a wake-up call for a lot of the issues that you and I are discussing. And first and foremost, to build awareness of how and why I think we've gotten off the tracks and have allowed our debate to be led by the loudest voices. And once people realize that they've been led astray, then I'm hoping good things can happen. There are a whole series of prescriptions that I could lay out for you, but awareness is job one.
Awareness meaning that people have to see through experience that what they thought would get them where they want to be didn't happen.
True, and that they've been led astray by so-called leaders, both in the media and in the electoral process.
The media. Does the media matter?
The media, unfortunately, really matters. It matters too much because the media has such control over those who come out in primary elections, and then you've got a whole host of folks who get to make a choice between someone far to the left or far to the right in a general election where perhaps they didn't have a say in how they were nominated to begin with.
Number one change you'd make to the media?
To the media. Well, it's not as if I would impose
out.
Any.
No,
I, it's not as if I would impose any government control. I'm not here advocating for a fairness doctrine. What the change I'd most like is to break people of a Fox only mindset or an MSNBC mindset. You know, you're really not as well read simply by being tuned in to one particular channel 24/7.
Your man Reagan liked the fairness doctrine.
Yeah, I got into broadcasting just as it was ending on his watch. So
what do you think of that? What do you think that meant in terms of what we became as a culture?
Well, we didn't have choice the way that we do now. You know, the technological explosion has given us so many outlets. I laugh when people will refer to the mainstream media or the conservative or liberal. The media today is whatever you want it to be. Whatever viewpoint is out there, you can find. And that's fine. I just want you to sample a number of them.
So let me ask you a couple of prognostication questions.
Oh, boy. We've been doing so well.
Well, but here's the thing, because on my show, I ask you things. You never answer the specific question. You kind of go off. You do whatever you want to do.
That's
maybe on
true.
Your show, you'll be more direct.
Go ahead.
Do the Democrats take the House?
Yes.
I say no. Do the Democrats make gains in the Senate?
They will not take control of the Senate. Maybe they pick up a seat, but I don't see them taking control of the Senate.
Agreed. Does President Trump run again?
50-50.
He runs. If he runs, do you think he wins?
Well, you want to bet against me in this category because every primary and caucus victory I thought would be his last. And I hope I'm not hedging, but you got to give me a matchup. I mean, if Joe Biden is his opposition, he loses.
Who loses?
Trump.
To Joe Biden?
To Joe Biden.
On what theory?
On the theory that Biden is the individual who can bring back to the Democratic fold those Rust Belt, high school educated, working class guys who could never stomach Hillary. Biden, they'd be four.
Counterargument, he owns the Obama legacy, which is getting pounded by Trump rightly and wrongly on a regular basis. Joe Biden walks into it, Mr. Congeniality. The media then turns on him, right? Because they all build you up
to then tear you down. Until you get in.
So now they scrutinize him 100 different ways. Oh, look at this picture of him saying hello to this woman in this way. And remember when he said this. And look what he did with Obama on that. And justify all these different things the administration did that Trump has undone and left us with this great economy, if it is strong at that time. Now what?
Let me say it this way. I think Biden beats him. I can tell you that there are a whole host of Democratic candidates that I think cannot defeat Donald Trump.
Can any other Democratic candidate?
Bernie Sanders? Can't do it.
Can't do it.
Elizabeth Warren? Cannot
do
it. Cannot be someone from that side of the party, in my opinion.
It has to be someone more centrist?
Yes. Someone who's going to break free those voters that the typical Democratic constituency couldn't hold together.
What kind of wager you want to make on this?
Here's
what I want.
Yeah.
Because you're probably going to lose.
Remember, I'm not making a dime from the book, so
now,
go easy.
Is that
on
true?
Me. Yeah.
Because I was looking, and did you form a 501c3 for the purposes?
No, the Children's Crisis Treatment Center, which benefits
CCTC,
which benefits kids who are victims of trauma in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. Chris, the worst of the worst conditions and situations, they're getting whatever I earn from this. My wife's on the board.
Every dollar goes to the best cause.
Yes, absolutely. So dislike me if you choose, buy the book anyway.
Do you think people dislike you in general?
No, I don't know if they do or not.
I think you're very popular. Though I want to ask you this. Do you feel that they cut off a little bit of the top of your head?
Probably the best part.
Why? I think you have one of the best shaped heads in the business. I want you to know that. And this is on. Now, you're sideways here. Why? The book cover, right? Smerconish is this way. Why do you think that is?
I think it's a whole play on this guy is very difficult to identify one way or the other. Whitney Cookman, who designed John Grisham's The Firm with the lawyer climbing up the exterior.
What are you name-dropping? Name-dropping on your own show?
He designed the jacket. And everybody took a haircut, no pun intended, because it's for charity.
So I am getting into the nighttime game. As you know, I am a student of what you do and a big admirer. The criticism of this is this is not what people want. This they want. This is a good
let's
interview.
Prove them wrong.
Because you know you give good answers. But you are neither fish nor fowl. And if you are neither fish nor fowl, you are unappetizing to both palates.
Listen, I'm so glad you brought this up because I am on a one-man mission, two-man mission to prove them all
wrong. One and a half.
To prove them all wrong. I don't think you need to be. By the way,
it's not
Chris,
easy. Do you see how people's faces change when they say, you tell me that, and they lay out whatever it is. And when you're like, well, look, you got to look at this also,
Chris,
though. Their faces change like, ugh.
That group of broadcaster who go on night after night and claim to see it all one way or all the other? You think they mean everything they say? I may be wrong, but I mean everything I say. Had to take back some of the things that I meant in the past, but I mean it. I think you mean it. And I wish people would see through those charlatans who are only after ratings and are preying on the ideological leanings of some of their audience to do that.
You know, look, I hear you, little egalitarian. I think that the ratings, the success speaks for itself.
Driven by passion.
Driven by passion. Look at where I'm going. You know, the the most silly move professionally that I could make right now is to go into the 9 p.m. time slot because you've got the biggest names in the business.
Oh, I think
there.
It takes some guts,
I just believe the need is great.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I have tremendous respect for the success. But we understand that the dynamic isn't working, right? Maddow is a brilliant and cogent person who is arguing from a certain perspective, and she drills down on facts very good. Hannity is a fire breather who's got these people tapping into their passions, and their ratings are the biggest we've ever seen. But so is the chasm. That's my concern. Hooray for their success.
I don't believe that either of them represent the nation at large. I don't. When I'm leading my
life... Big audiences.
Yes, but driven by passion. I believe that most reside somewhere between Maddow and Hannity, but they need to be stirred, and they need to want to take their country back. Listen, when I'm leading my life, pumping gas, back to school night, grocery shopping, and people engage me, traveling, and now that I'm somewhat recognizable because of CNN, they constantly engage me, and they will say to me that they don't see the world that way. They're liberal on some things, usually social issues, conservative on others, usually the fiscal issues. That viewpoint is not represented. That's what I think you're going to be able to do.
If you can get to the policy, my experience has been that the predilections, the passion is all based on the surface. So either they feel, what I get most often is, you're either too hard on the president or you're not hard enough on the president. And what I see episodically is when I go at somebody or when I say, oh, this is going to be a peace prize if they get, peace on the peninsula. Somebody's always unhappy. And that's a scary thought about where their heads are right now. My concern is, my fear, to take it back to where your book begins, 9/11 was a horrible, horrible thing any way that you want to measure an event, except one. It was a supervening event that made people clear their heads of a lot of other things for a moment. It was a tremendous force in my own life. I lost a bunch of my guys. I wound up getting engaged 11 days after it because of it. I had to start living my life. I had a woman who was way over my head. It was time to lock it in if I could get lucky. I got married less than 2 months later, started our life together. Best decision I've ever made for her. She can answer for herself. But that's the kind of thing that can shake people free. God forbid, I do not want that to happen. I'd rather stay mired in what we are than ever invite that kind of ugliness on anybody's life. But I don't know what else shakes it free because it's too easy to play to advantage in the current dynamic. Look at Trump. He knows how to play this kind of division. He knows how to show that he's a change agent for what matters. He knows how to vilify the other side because he knows he's got a willing audience with an appetite for division.
So let me now play the interviewer role and say, it seems to me what I'm hearing from Chris Cuomo is that you're moving to prime time because professionally, that's the area to which everybody aspires. But also, you recognize we are at a moment in time as a country where you could do great value for the nation in breaking that logjam. True?
That is the hope. You know, I get asked now when you're starting a show, as you know, they say, do you think you'll be able to do better? I say, yes. Why else would I do it
right.
if I don't think I could do better?
Right.
Then I'd say give the opportunity to somebody else.
Better for the country. The country will be well served by you succeeding.
I think that upsetting people's frame of reference and thought is a good thing. You don't want to be theatrical about it. You don't want to be openly hostile, or hollow in your criticisms. But I think it is good for people to be thinking about why they're thinking what they're thinking. I think that's what we do here. You do it brilliantly. I do it best I can. But I think there's a need for it. I don't know if there's an appetite for it, but I know that there's a need for it. And a little bit of it will be a referendum on the people. You know, when you poll people about what they want on television, they always say, I want real news. Don't give me any of this entertainment
right.
stuff. And then they watch the opposite of what they suggest they want. This is one of those tests. If you're saying you don't want to be siloed, if you're saying you're tired of the partisan division,
yep.
Well, then let's see.
Good.
Because now's your chance.
Good.
When's the next book come out?
I think this is it.
What?
I
Why?
Think this is it.
No, this is the only book you have in you?
No. This is the only one that matters to me now. How's that?
Let me tell you something. For you to put this kind of work in this.
Chris, I recorded every column and afterword for audible.com. That was perhaps the hardest part of all. And if that outtake reel should ever see the light of day, I'm done.
Listen, you put a lot of work into it because you're doing it for two causes that mean so much to you. One, public dialogue, of having people understand ideas and chew on them.
It's true.
And then you're helping kids in the worst kind of battle with cancer and their families. What could be better than that? I will buy many copies of this book.
How many?
And how many do you want me to buy? Tell me right now. I'll tell you what.
You claim you got 9 for free out of me, and none of them signed. So
Let me see. What's the list price on this before I say how many I'm going to buy?
It's going to be? Just under $30.
$30?
Yeah. No, don't make a statement that you'll regret later. Believe me, I know I have your support.
Well, I got you on the mom thing already. We both know there's no way she hit a home run. I'm going to buy a bunch of your books.
Thanks.
And it's okay that this is the first time I've ever interviewed anyone about a book, including people in prison for good reason, where they didn't sign a copy of the book.
That's not true, but okay.
It is 100% true. Michael Smerconish.
Thank you, man.
Thank you for everything. And you're a mensch.
And by the way, good luck.
Thank you.
We need you. The nation needs you in prime time.
June 1st.
Yeah.
Clowns to the left of me, like right now. Jokers to the right.
Wait a minute. That would be you the clown.
Yeah, I know.
Me the joker.
That's right.
Okay.
Thank you, Smirk. Always a pleasure.